Hey everybody, it's Lindsay. This week, week three, we are going to talk about what is health equity. This is the name of the class, you know, 328, health equity. But what is health equity? Why does it exist? Why is it something that we need to think about? Why is this a requirement for all of our courses in this major? There's a little video about sort of what is health equity and why is it so important. But the biggest sort of factor that we need to look at is when we look at sort of the health impact pyramid created by CDC and other public health professionals, we look at different sort of things that affect people's health. Obviously, when we look at clinical interventions and other sort of protective things, we're looking at people's behavior. And this is often where we focus in terms of health and other sort of things is, well, if people would do the right things to be healthy, so get, you know, the required amount of exercise, eat healthy, do these sort of things, don't do drugs, use contraceptives, all of those sort of things. And yes, those are important. Those are things that we really need to work on and show. But if we look at sort of the determinants of health and what determines whether or not we're healthy, health behaviors and sort of clinical interventions make up a pretty small amount of our overall sort of health behaviors. Yes, altogether, they make a big sort of thing. But when we look at sort of socioeconomic factors and physical environment and those sort of things, those things make up a much larger percentage of our health. And so those are things that most of us can't control. And those are things that create difference and create sort of disadvantages in our health that are things that are unequally applied and hit us in different sort of ways. So what are socioeconomic factors? Some of them are pretty self-explanatory. Economics, so looking at sort of income distribution, looking at jobs, looking at economic sort of forces. We have some control over that, but as we start to look at systemic sort of issues, we see that certain kinds of people get marginalized by the system that goes through it. Environment, we like to think that we choose where we live, but we also will find out throughout the semester that our environment is largely dictated to us in a lot of different sort of ways that come from big systemic sort of issues in the past. Government, whether we feel that we're represented by our government, whether we feel that we have access to our government, those sort of things are socioeconomic factors. Infrastructure, so whether or not you have good schools, whether or not you have good roads, whether or not you have pollution, those sort of things are big picture things that most of us don't have individual control over. They're sort of dictated by our environment. Our education, our educational access, you know, do we get to go to certain schools? Do we have the ability to navigate different sort of systems? And then finally, our population. So looking at sort of what do our families look like? What do our households look like? Who do we live with? What are the structures of these sort of things? Again, things that we say, like, yes, there are some of those things that we make a choice in, but when we look at bigger systemic factors, we'll talk about choice and what does that actually mean. The reason that this is important is because in public health, we very much believe in the socio-ecological model of health. The social-ecological model of health, the SEM, is a model that says, yes, we are all individual people. We are people who are in control of our lives. However, the socio-ecological model also says not only are we people who live individual lives, we also live within our family systems, right? We also live within communities. We also live within a wider sort of political spectrum. And all those different layers of things will have an effect on our health and how we interact sort of with the world. And so it's an important sort of model because we want to acknowledge that individual actors alone can't have complete control over their lives. We know that everybody is affected by things that are going on around them. And so the socio-ecological model is a way to look at the person who is, yes, very important and in the middle, but is surrounded by all these layers of other sort of things. So that brings us up to things such as what is the role of government? It depends on who you ask and what sort of political perspective you have. And so I like to look back way sort of in time. The Code of Hammurabi was the very first codified way to talk about government. Hammurabi was a king, and he said, hey, we should talk about sort of different ways that people are able to navigate their life. And if we have a government system that is sort of above the people, what is the role of government to do? And Hammurabi said the first role of government is to protect the powerless against the powerful. And so part of this is ingrained in terms of health equity. Health equity is looking at people who are not doing well for whatever whatever sort of reason. And the role of government is to say, hey, we should help these people. We shouldn't let them just flounder sort of on their own. And so we want to be able to help people to achieve a role of health. Fast forward to sort of the founding of our country. The preamble to the US Constitution says that the goals of the United States are to form a more perfect union. Again, that's kind of open. Establishing justice, which is important. Ensuring domestic tranquility. So we want to have everything cool and peaceful. Providing for common defense. That's usually our war sort of stuff. Promoting general welfare. So everybody should have the ability to be healthy. And securing the blessing of liberty. Those are all in the Constitution, codified by the founding fathers. And so looking at sort of things of establishing justice, domestic tranquility, general welfare are all things that are sort of roundabout ways talking about people's health. Now, again, all of this is open to interpretation by individuals. But for a lot of people, particularly people in public health, we believe those are sort of the tenets and the roles that say, yeah, actually public health is a social issue. It's something that we as people, whether it be part of government or private industry, we should be providing for the welfare of others. Which brings us to our next question. Is health a human right? That's been a very big debate in terms of what is a human right? Who is supposed to provide for human rights? Should the government provide human rights, or should they just get out of the way to make sure that you are able to have your human rights? Well, that's another political sort of debate, but if we can look at to our sort of other sort of historical documents, we can look to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which was created by the United Nations. The United Nations is the supranational organization that we look to kind of guide how do countries behave, how should they behave, how do they interact together. While it doesn't have any binding forces because of national sovereignty, where each country gets to make their own sort of decisions, people have decided, yes, we want to willingly contribute to the United Nations, and we're going to agree to some different sort of sets of things. This is where the Universal Declaration of Human Rights came from. Article 25 of the UN Declaration of Human Rights says everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health of himself, his family, including food, clothing, housing, medical care, and necessary social services. So that sounds pretty much like health in the public health sort of system. People should be able to access health care. They should be able to have safe environments. They should be able to have a standard of living that doesn't prevent them from being able to be marginalized in any sort of way. Again, a lot of people are like, yeah, well, that's just some like supranational sort of thing and blah, blah, blah. The actual person who wrote the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was Eleanor Roosevelt, who was the first lady at the time. And so this has a uniquely American voice in it. And so people still debate whether or not, you know, the UN should have any sort of say over individual country decisions and lives. But I think it's a really important sort of thing to think about. So this brings us to the idea of health equity and social justice, right? Social justice is a concept that talks about fair and just relations between individuals and society. We think that everybody should have that equal opportunity to have a good life and other sort of things. This is measured by explicit but also tacit terms for distribution of wealth, opportunities for personal activity, social privileges, other sort of things. Why the bad rap? Well, we have gotten sort of this idea from a lot of different political persuasions that social justice is just this like really crazy thing that, you know, those social justice warriors are always promoting. I don't know why that's a bad thing, right? Social justice is a good thing. We want people to have an equal opportunity. It doesn't say we have to give everyone everything, but it says we need to provide an environment in which everybody can achieve health, can do these sort of things, and that they shouldn't be limited because of things such as race or ethnicity or religion or other sort of things. And so we should be able to say, yeah, it is okay to be just and to think about these sort of things. So why should you care about it? Well, there's a really great TED talk I'm going to have you watch about social justice and why it's important. How do we go beyond sort of just, yes, I've done the standard of care that is expected of me and I have done nothing wrong, to how do I go beyond that to make sure that things are just and equal? We know that the American Public Health Association, which is the professional organization for people who are engaged in public health, is heavily supportive of social justice. It's actually one of the tenets of the American Public Health Association. SOFI, which is our Society for Public Health Education, if you're a health educator, the code of ethics includes social justice. ACHE, which is the code for health or health administrators, doesn't have the specific sort of commitment to social justice, but it does hint at it in a lot of different sort of things. And if you look at the ACHE programs for their annual conferences and other things, social justice has been an issue. But most importantly, what I always like to say is, why should you care about social justice? Well, you should, because it's what is fair and what is just. Everybody should have an equal opportunity, and nobody should be denied opportunities just because of who they are and where they were born, right? Again, going back to that, nobody asked to be born into any sort of family or any sort of life, and we're all just trying to do our best. And so social justice says, hey, everybody should have the same equal opportunity. We should have the chance to do these sort of things, and if there are structural barriers or if there are systemic barriers in the way, we need to eradicate those so that people can have that opportunity, right? A lot of what the U.S. is based on is sort of all men are created equal. Everybody has a right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. Well, social justice says, yeah, well, let's just actually make sure that that's true. Let's make sure that everybody is having equal access to have those sort of things, and that there's nothing that's being in the way that is going to impede the pursuit of those sort of things. Okay. At the end of the day, you get to decide, how committed to social justice are you? Do you want to do just sort of the basics of your job? That's totally fine. Or do you want to care about bigger sort of issues? I care about bigger issues. I want to talk about, why do we need to talk about justice and these sort of things? And so that's where I leave you here in terms of health. It's not okay when we say little black children don't get as much medication as little white children because of these weird sort of ideas that we hold. It's not okay that some kids live near really dirty sort of rivers and can't play in them. It's not fair that people have unequal access to healthy air sort of quality and these sort of things. And so I think that there's something that we can do as a society. And I think it's our role and our job as a caring society to care for all the other people who are around here. Okay. For this week's activity, I'm going to have you do a activity looking at the social determinants of health and socioeconomic factors and thinking about how those things play out in people's lives and how it affects their health. It's pretty self-explanatory, but if you have any questions, shoot me a message and I will get back to you on those sort of things. All right. Have a great week.